On behalf of SPJIMR Institute of Management and Research, SPJIMR, I will be your host today. We have with us here esteemed speakers, luminaries from the industry, my faculty colleagues, staff, and student from SPJIMR. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to the 8th SPJIMR Business Academia Conclave. SBAC, as we call it, stands for an active engagement between academia and industry. Today we have here some of the finest academicians and leaders of some of the largest corporations in India. We believe when these two worlds meet, exciting ideas can emerge. To that, if we had ideas from beyond the world of business, we can open ourselves to even more interesting opportunities to learn. At SPJIMR, it is our mission to influence practice. And events like SBAC are the platforms through which we drive our mission. We believe that debate and dialogue between academia and industry in open forums can create new thoughts and new practices. And SBAC is a conscious effort towards that direction. We are part of Bharati Vidya Bhavan, which is recognized by the government as an institute of national importance. And while we have many programs, we have only one campus. We are situated in the heart of Mumbai, in Andheri. It's a 45-acre campus. It's extremely green. We have a lovely lake. In fact, I'd like to invite you sometime to visit us. It is also with a bit of pride I would like to mention that last year, in 2016, SPJIMR was declared by AACSB, which is an international accreditation body, to be one of the world's top 30 most innovative B schools. We were the only Indian school. Thank you. We were the only Indian school and one of the two Asian schools to achieve this distinction. With that, coming back to this event, innovation is an idea, a concern, a question that is heard across business schools and boardrooms. And today's theme is innovation. There will be rich exchange of ideas and of cases shared by our speakers today. And I would like to mention that we will be preparing a white paper with a summary of the thoughts that emerged today. And this will be shared by all the attendees today by February 15th. On a lighter note, we professors have very peculiar reaction to ringing cell phones mid-sessions, so requesting you guys to please put them on silent mode. With that, I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker. Dr. Vijay Govindarajan, known as VG, is regarded as one of the world's leading experts on strategy and innovation. A New York Times and Wall Street Journal best-selling author, he's a Cox Distinguished Professor at Tuck School of Business and Marvin Bauer Fellow at Harvard Business School, where he was awarded the Robert Brown Prize for the Best Thesis Proposal. VG has worked with CEOs and top management teams in more than 25% of Fortune 500 firms. He was the first professor in residence and chief innovation consultant at General Electric. His Harvard Business Review article that pioneered the concept of reverse innovation is considered as one of the greatest moments in management in the last century. In the latest Thinkers 50 ranking, Dr. Govindarajan was ranked as number one Indian management thinker. He was ranked by Management International Review as one of the top 20 North American superstars for research and strategy. While he was in India, I must mention this, he won the President's Gold Medal for standing first all India in the Chartered Accountancy Examination. In fact, it's a very interesting claim. He won 6 out of the 7 gold medals, and the only gold medal he missed out was the best student, ladies student of the year. His family loves traveling, and I believe in 2014, they literally saw the world. They started by visiting Australia and then ended up by visiting Antarctica. So can I please invite Dr. Govindarajan on stage?
In the afternoon on a Wednesday. This is an extremely difficult time slot to give a presentation. See, what happens this time of the day when you start giving presentations? After about 15 minutes of presentation, you tend to lose 50% of the audience. They're gone. Not physically, but mentally they kind of wandered away. In fact, what research shows this time of the day when you start giving presentations, after about 30 minutes of presentation, you tend to lose 75% of the audience. After about 45 minutes of presentation, you tend to lose 100% of the audience. So by 2:15, all of you will be gone. What research shows, this time of the day when your mind begins to wander away, what it wanders to is your wildest fantasies. So at least at the minimum, it'll be an exciting 45 minutes. That's all I can promise. The topic that was given to me was, how can we make India an innovation capital in the next 25 years? Of course, you can approach the topic in so many different ways. We can approach it at a macro level. What can the country do? And one can think of any number of ideas. How about fundamentally changing our education system, which is focused on problem solving, to problem discovery, which requires a fundamental rethinking of our education system all the way, starting from school to college? That could be one idea. A second idea could be, why don't we attract all the engineers and technologists who are of Indian origin, who are leading in their fields, who have settled abroad, why don't we begin to attract them back into India, perhaps by creating world-class universities? A third proposal could be, why don't the Indian government sort of make doing business easy, really open the doors and make startup and entrepreneurship easy to do in India? These are all kind of macro proposals. One can think of Prime Minister Modi appointing a high-level commission and saying, instead of make in India, our slogan should be innovate in India. And what can we do? And what can we start today so that India can be an innovation leader 25 years from today? That could be one way we can take the conversation. The way I want to take the conversation is at a micro level. What can companies do to be innovative? And the innovation that I'm interested in is not incremental innovation. I'm interested in non-linear innovation, breakthrough innovation, exponential innovation. By the way, I got interested in this topic really growing up in India. You see, your formative years really inform you as to what you become. I grew up in an extremely poor family. And in my formative years, what I saw was lots and lots of problems and very few resources. And if you face lots and lots of problems and very few resources, one thing is clear. You can solve your problem only through breakthrough innovation. We can't throw money at the problem, we don't have money. That's why I really got interested in nonlinear innovation, breakthrough innovation. And when I went to the US, I committed myself, I will study this topic and really begin to understand what it takes to excel in breakthrough innovation. And in the initial phases of my career, I really helped American companies to engage in breakthrough innovation. And in 2008 and 2009, I took a leave of absence from Dartmouth and worked full-time with General Electric and worked with Jeff Immelt as his chief innovation officer. And Jeff Immelt asked me to come to India and China and told me, try to figure out how we can accelerate GE's growth in India and China. That sort of brought me full circle, back to India, where it all started for me. And that's where we created this idea of reverse innovation. We did some fun projects in breakthrough innovation in India, and then took those innovations to other countries, including the US. What do I mean by breakthrough innovation? A good example would be a couple of years ago, you remember India's mission to Mars? When India launched its satellite to Mars, at that time, only three countries have launched satellite to Mars. One was the United States, second was European Space Agency, and third is Russian Space Agency. The fourth country to do it is a poor country called India. But that's not the point. The point is India's mission to Mars costed $75 million. About the same time, America launched a mission to Mars, and that costed $2 billion. India spent $75 million on a project on which US spends $2,000 million. By the way, both are doing the same job. As we are talking, both the satellites are circling around Mars. This is what I mean by nonlinear innovation, breakthrough innovation. In fact, just about the time when India launched its mission to Mars, Hollywood produced a movie. Perhaps you may have seen it. It's called Gravity. This movie is about a failed mission to Mars. And that movie costed $150 million. So a Hollywood make-believe failed mission to Mars cost twice as much as India's successful mission to Mars. This is the kind of breakthrough thinking we need more of in India. And the timing couldn't be perfect. Brexit, Donald Trump, basically are shutting the doors. Therefore, India's growth cannot be based on export to rich countries. India's next phase of growth has to be about innovating in India for India. Now, what is the innovation challenge in India? If we have to focus on India and Indian consumers, what is the innovation challenge? What is the breakthrough innovation challenge? One way I can frame it is, I think there is not just one India, there are three Indias. There is India number one. India number one primarily resides in the four metros, Madras, Calcutta, Bombay, and Delhi, and probably another 12 tier one cities. And tier one city would be any city with, say, 4 million population and above. This would be Bangalore, Hyderabad, Ahmedabad. So there are about 16 tier one cities and metros constitute probably India number one. India number one is the most developed India. Most corporations have innovated for India number one, because India number one can take products from the West. That's a low-hanging fruit. That is where most of the innovation so far has focused. Then there is India number two. If India number one is the top of the economic pyramid, India number two is the middle of the economic pyramid. That's a big chunk. That is the emerging India. That is the developing India. That probably resides in tier two, tier three, tier four small towns. The per capita income of India number one probably is 5 times more than the per capita income of India number two. So if you want to really innovate for India number two, you have to do breakthrough innovation. You can't simply take products we have given for India number one and offer it to India number two, because at a minimum, the affordability is so different. You have to engage in nonlinear innovation. Then there is India number three. And India number three is the largest India. And India number three resides primarily in the 650 villages, 650,000 villages. Now, in terms of, and India number three is the underdeveloped India. India number two probably has 5 times the per capita income of India number three. I say the biggest innovation opportunity for Indian companies is to come up with breakthrough innovation for India number two. And if you want to seize India number three, you have to do another breakthrough innovation. This, I contend, is the biggest innovation opportunity. By the way, if we can do this innovation effectively, then the affordable, high-quality solutions we offer for India number two and India number three, we can take to other emerging markets and perhaps even to rich countries like the US eventually. This is the reverse innovation opportunity I say Indian corporations must seize. What is an example? Think about Narayana Health. Now, the amazing thing about Narayana Health is open heart surgery in Narayana Health costs $3,000. Open heart surgery in the US costs $150,000. Because open heart surgery in Narayana Health costs 50 times less, doesn't mean their quality is 50 times inferior. I don't even know how you can do poor quality heart surgery. One measure of quality in heart surgery is mortality rates 30 days after surgery. For Narayana Health, their mortality rates 30 days after surgery is 1.2%. And the US average is 2%. So their quality is actually on par, maybe even slightly ahead of the US. By the way, innovation in India means not making cheap products. Actually, it is making products at a world-class quality level. And surprising as it may be, the quality demanded by India number two and India number three is even higher than the quality demanded by consumers in the West. That is certainly true for open heart surgery. If someone is doing an open heart surgery, say in the best US hospital, Mayo Clinic, the surgeon doesn't have to have the same high skill to reduce mortality as compared to doing the same open heart surgery on an Indian in Narayana Health in Bangalore. Why? You see, Indians tend to have bad hearts. Not bad people's hearts, but we tend to have weak hearts genetically. Therefore, the same procedure done on an Indian, the surgeon has to have higher quality. Not only that, the pollution in India is terrible as compared to the US. Hygienic conditions in India are not as good as in the US. Therefore, post-surgery, mortality tends to be high in India. If you adjust for these risk factors, what Narayana Health has achieved is truly remarkable. Not only that, Narayana Health does not deny open heart surgery for anybody. If someone cannot pay, they do it free. So much so, one third of the customers don't pay. It is only the remaining two thirds pay. And the two thirds pay 50 times less than what we pay in the US. And Narayana Health is not a charity. It's not a non-profit organization. It is a profit maximizer as much as Mahindra Mahindra or Tata or any other private sector company. Can you believe this? A profit maximizing firm gives away its product to one third of the customer free of cost. Therefore, for one third of the customer, selling price equals zero. And they only charge for the remaining two thirds. And the remaining two thirds, they charge 50 times less than what we charge in the US. And recover the cost of 100% of their customers from two thirds paying customers. And Narayana Health turns out to be the most profitable cardiac hospital in the world. Can you believe this? And Narayana Health is clearly targeted at India number two and India number three. And guess what? Last year, Dr. Devi Shetty, who founded Narayana Health, clearly he got the inspiration from Mother Teresa. That's where he got the inspiration to be compassionate, to do more with less, to do a lot more with a lot less for a lot of people. And Dr. Devi Shetty and Narayana Health have opened an open heart surgery facility in Cayman Islands. This is going to be the largest cardiac hospital in the world. And as you know, Cayman Islands is a 1 hour flight from Miami. And this cardiac facility is targeted at US patients. And he wants to demonstrate how you can do open heart surgery for a fraction of the cost it takes to do it in the US. And then have 3 week vacation in Cayman Islands. This is what I mean by reverse innovation. An innovation that starts in Bangalore and then transforms the lives of people in the US. This is the biggest innovation opportunity for Indian companies. And if you want to crack open this breakthrough innovation opportunity, then I think we can learn some lesson from superstar Rajinikanth. By the way, I grew up in Madras watching Kamala Hassan and Rajinikanth movies. And I think superstar Rajinikanth knows how to do nonlinear innovation. I remember one movie where in the last 20 minutes of the movie, the villain ties down Rajinikanth and kidnaps the heroine in a Mercedes, of course. And then the police jump into their van and start to chase the Mercedes. And the police van plays by the same rules as the Mercedes plays, but only thing is the police van is a little slower. Therefore, in the movie, you can see the gap between the police van and the Mercedes keeps on increasing. Now, after about 10 minutes, Rajinikanth unties himself, and he knows one thing. He is already 10 minutes too late. He can't catch up with the Mercedes through incremental thinking. And we know one thing. Superstar Rajinikanth is a nonlinear thinker. So what does he do? He jumps on top of a horse. You see, a horse can go on roads where the cars can't go. So he goes through a lot of back alleys, climbs a mountain, and jumps in front of the Mercedes. That is thinking differently. I have learned a lot from superstar Rajinikanth about how to do nonlinear innovation. And I'm going to share with you 5 principles that I learned from him that Indian companies can put to good use. The first principle is set leapfrog challenges. Set audacious goals. Superstar Rajinikanth never settles for something incremental. He is always thinking big. He is always thinking in leapfrog terms. Now, why is a leapfrog challenge the starting point for nonlinear innovation? Take, for instance, a leapfrog challenge that John F. Kennedy threw to the United States in the early 60s. We will put a man on the moon and bring him back before the end of this decade. The scientific community put the probability we can do it at 20%. Optimistic probability, if I might add. There was a good 80% chance we cannot do it. Leapfrog challenges, almost by definition, is to have a big dream. Have an outrageous ambition. Have an unrealistic goal. Why do you need an unrealistic goal as the starting point for nonlinear innovation? It's common sense. Why? Because as human beings, our performance is always a function of our expectations. We rarely exceed our expectation. We rarely outperform our ambition. If your ambition is to go to the moon, and if you try hard, you may get to the treetop. But if you only want to get to the treetop, you may never even lift off from the ground. Yet, I want you to think about in organizations how many processes we have. Goal setting process, performance evaluation process, which panders to mediocrity, which supports incremental thinking. Think about two managers in your company. One manager says, I can grow this business at 150% a year for the next 5 years, but ends up growing the business only at 140%. There is another manager out here who says, I can grow the business at 1% a year for the next 5 years. Then beats the budget, beats the target, beats the goal, and gives you 2% growth. Which manager deserves the bonus? Which manager ends up getting the bonus? We have so many processes which puts limits on human beings, doesn't open up possibilities. Principle one, start having leapfrog challenges. Principle two, I say process beats talent. And superstar Rajinikanth exemplifies this better than anyone else. He's not good looking. He was a bus conductor. And he really created a process where he is a superstar. And in every one of his movies, it is the process that really comes to the surface in solving the humongous problem. Think about Mumbai Dabbawalas. Mumbai Dabbawalas have ordinary talent. In fact, though Dabbawalas at best have high school degrees. They don't use any technology. Yet, they deliver lunchbox better than FedEx can deliver. They are 20 times better in terms of Six Sigma because they've created a world-class process. Ultimately, breakthrough innovation requires you to think about process, which can make even ordinary talent do extraordinary things. If you want a concrete example, think about the Rio Olympics. Those of you who watched the Rio Olympics, you probably recognize this name, Katie Ledecky. Katie Ledecky is one of the most sensational US freestyle swimmers. She really swims in the long distance freestyle. Currently, she is the world record holder in 400 meter, 800 meter, and 1500 meter freestyle. She is all of 19 years old. In fact, she came into prominence in London Olympics when she won the gold in 800 meter freestyle. At that time, she was 15 years old. Now, the interesting thing about Katie Ledecky is when she was 6 years old, they did an elite athlete test on her and concluded she is remarkably unremarkable. What it means is she is not built to be a freestyle swimmer. She is not ridiculously tall. She doesn't have long hands. She doesn't have big feet. Why do you need to be tall and have long hands and big feet is in freestyle, you can cover a lap with fewer strokes. You look at Michael Phelps. He is built for freestyle. He looks like a big fish. And Katie Ledecky did not have the talent, they concluded, to be in freestyle. She could have given up. Instead, what she said was, I am going to invent a freestyle that's so dramatically different. Invent a new process which uses my strengths. You are telling me I'm not talented in the current paradigm of freestyle. If I change the paradigm, I can actually neutralize all the talented people. For instance, by the way, even today, when you watch Katie Ledecky, she probably takes 3 times more strokes to finish a lap as compared to the best freestylers. So she has a handicap there. So what she did was, for instance, she has a tremendous kick. She has tremendous hip strength. She has tremendous catch with her hand of the water. Therefore, when you watch her on freestyle, she uses kicks a lot more than other freestylers. Not only that, she has tremendous stamina. In the freestyle, because it's a long race, the conventional process was you race the first 100 meters, then you pace the next 600 meters so that you can conserve energy, and then give it all in the last 100 meters. This is the conventional process. Katie Ledecky, she races the first 100 meters. Then she races even faster in the next 600 meters and then gives it all in the last 100 meters. If you can shift the paradigm of the process, then talent gets neutralized. The principle number three I learned from superstar Rajinikanth is never face reality. Instead, choose your own enabling reality. Reality is not just one thing. In any given situation, there are multiple realities. Choose a reality which is enabling to you. Most of us focus on a reality that limits us and try to solve that problem. And superstar Rajinikanth never gets trapped in focusing on limiting reality. Now, what is a good example? Think about Dainik Bhaskar, the newspaper group. In 11 years, this is a local language newspaper. In 11 years, they are the number one newspaper group in India in terms of circulation. They are number four newspaper group in the world. Now, why is this remarkable? Because they ignored the reality and chose an enabling reality. Now, what is the reality in the newspaper business? You see, even if you are entering a city where there is absolutely no other newspaper, you are the first newspaper to enter the city, you don't enter with big volume because of the economics of the newspaper industry. The economics of the newspaper industry is every time you sell a newspaper, you lose money. Because subscription never catches up with the cost of producing a newspaper, unless the ad revenues, until the ad revenues catch up. Therefore, the conventional wisdom in newspaper industry is you launch with a small quantity, let the ad revenues catch up. Once that catches up, you launch the next volume and slowly build the volume over time. When Dainik Bhaskar entered Jaipur, that was the first city they entered, there were already three newspapers which were well entrenched. There was one newspaper which was the market share leader with 100,000 copies, a second newspaper with 50,000 copies, a third newspaper with 25,000 copies. By the way, the newspaper with 100,000 copies built the market leadership over 30 years. So Dainik Bhaskar is not even entering a city which has got no newspaper. They're entering a city which has already got well-established incumbents. Another reality in newspaper business is if you enter a city with well-established incumbents, it is difficult to change the morning habit. This is like your morning beverage. You never switch. This is the reality Dainik Bhaskar faced. They could have attacked the reality. Instead, they said, I'm going to ignore this reality and create another reality. What did Dainik Bhaskar do? When they entered Jaipur, they identified households which did not subscribe to a newspaper. When they don't subscribe to a newspaper, there is no morning habit to break. This may be in India number two and India number three. Then they also identified households which were affluent in India number one, but they could afford to subscribe a second newspaper. So they identified 200,000 households which either did not subscribe to a newspaper or could afford to subscribe one more. Therefore, you choose an enabling reality which doesn't limit you. Another reality in newspaper industry is whenever you launch a newspaper, you only do a random sample. In terms of market research, you only do a random sample and then extrapolate it to the population. Because you don't want to survey the 200,000 population. That's too expensive. But Dainik Bhaskar never thinks about facing reality. They create their enabling reality. So what Dainik Bhaskar did was, I am going to survey the entire 200,000. Of course, if you survey the entire 200,000, it's too expensive. What do you do? What they did was, they identified students in various universities in Jaipur and went to the college students and said, we have a market research project and we can't pay you. Would you like to come on board? Of course, the students ask, why should I participate in your market research when you're not going to pay us? They said three things. First, we are going to survey 200,000 people. That's pretty exciting. It's a massive project. Second, you need a job when you graduate. This would build your resume. You can say you worked somewhere. Third, if you did a great job, we will give you a job. Then they went to the unemployed youth in Jaipur. You don't have a job anyway. You're doing nothing. Why don't you come on board and do the market research? And if you do a good job, we can promise you a job later. In fact, they got 700 volunteers. And subsequently, they absorbed 50% of them in their own organization. And these 700 volunteers are not market researchers. They are young people with enthusiasm. So they gave them uniform, gave them training for a month in grooming, presentation, communication, etc. And they went to the 200,000 households and asked them, what do they need in a newspaper? And they got all kinds of feedback. Don't put gory pictures on the front page. Don't have big advertisements on the front page, whatever. Then they did something more incredible. They went back to the same 200,000 households a second time. This time, they had a mocked-up newspaper. They told them, you asked the following features in a newspaper. Here we have a prototype newspaper with everything that you want. Will you be willing to subscribe to this newspaper? The newspaper will, of course, come 9 months later. And if you are not satisfied with the newspaper, we'll give you money-back guarantee. But we need the subscription now because we are a small company. We don't have resources. In order to produce the newspaper, we want the subscription now. So they get prepaid subscription for 172,000 copies. Once they got subscriptions for 172,000 copies, they went to the advertisers. We have got guaranteed 172,000 subscription. Will you want to participate and put ads in our newspaper? And not only that, we know the economic profile of each and every one of our customers because they had interviewed every customer twice. Even before big data analytics became popular, they were doing that. Therefore, on day one, they launched with 172,000 copies. On day one, they were market share leaders because they ignored reality. Reality about morning habits, reality about placing TV ads to launch a newspaper, they placed no TV ads because their grassroots marketing was essentially an enrollment exercise. It's not just market research. In fact, one by one, they followed the same process in 20 cities in India. The next city they attacked was Ahmedabad. In Ahmedabad, they actually did market research twice with 1.2 million households. Of course, you don't have to do market research with every household if it is only market research. It was an enrollment exercise. If it is an enrollment exercise, you have to engage with every customer. In fact, in Ahmedabad, they launched on day one with 450,000 copies. In Guinness Book of World Records, you can see. This is the only newspaper on day one launched with 450,000 copies. A local language newspaper does not travel across cities in India, as you well know. This is the remarkable success you can achieve with breakthrough innovation if you ignore reality. The fourth principle is you must create a dedicated team. Breakthrough innovation cannot happen inside large companies. You have to create a separate space, an incubation lab, if you will. Think about Mahindra Mahindra. Scorpio SUV is clearly a breakthrough innovation for India number two. And in order to pull off Scorpio, they created a separate team. Or think about the journey General Electric is on today. They want to reinvent themselves as a software company. They are clearly a hardware player. They make aircraft engines. But aircraft engine has 100 sensors. And the 100 sensors, even a flight from, say, Bombay to Boston, collects millions and millions of data. about how fast is the plane flying, what is the fuel consumption, what are the maintenance needs in different parts. All those data are there in the aircraft engine. What GE is trying to do is to do predictive analysis, big data, trying to create actionable insights from that data. That is the software business they want to create. That GE Digital sits in Silicon Valley. It's a separate team. The last principle is, if you really want to create breakthrough innovation, you must begin to develop a capability in testing assumptions using low cost. Because big breakthrough projects are full of assumptions. They're full of unknowns. Therefore, you must create the capability to test assumptions by spending as little as possible. If the cost of experiment to test assumptions is low, then the cost of failure is low. Then the cost of learning is low. By the way, I want to make a distinction between failure and mistakes. I'm not talking about tolerating mistakes. I'm talking about tolerating failure, which is essentially converting assumptions into knowledge. Let me give you a quick example of what I mean by low-cost experiments to unlock these assumptions. IBM, in the mid-70s, decided to launch a big nonlinear innovation project. As you well know, IBM in the mid-70s was primarily a hardware company. They were making mainframe computers and selling it to corporations. At that time, IBM decided they will move into software. And the specific nonlinear project that they were thinking of was speech to text. So when you speak in front of the mainframe computer, it'll automatically convert that into text. Something like Siri in the B2C segment now. Now, if you want to create that software, it's going to cost millions and millions of dollars. You don't want to create that software and then figure out whether there is a market for it. Because in these nonlinear innovation, the market size is unknown on day one. So how do you understand whether there's a market for it? This is what IBM did. They brought their customer into a room like this, and the room had mainframe computers, and there was a microphone. And they told, and their customers were chief executive officers and senior executives, they told them, we have actually solved the problem and have created a software which can do speech to text. We want you to talk for an hour, and our software will convert your speech into text. Only thing is, they didn't actually solve the problem. They pretended they solved the problem. There were 100 typists who were sitting in the next room. As the executives are talking for an hour, the 100 typists are busily typing away. After an hour, what they found was the CEOs who were initially excited about the concept were no longer excited. Not because the text was incorrect. The text was 100% correct. That was not the problem. The problem was it hurt their throat when they talked for an hour. Or they didn't want to talk confidential stuff in front of the computer. My point is we need to find low-cost ways of trying to test these assumptions. If we can master these five principles, then I say the chance of success in nonlinear innovation goes way high up. And for Indian companies to really crack open India number two and India number three, we also need to fundamentally change the way we view our corporations. What I have on this grid is, on one axis, I have social heart and business heart. What that means is, social heart is doing good. Business heart is maximizing shareholder wealth. On the other axis, I have business mind and social mind. Business mind is doing all the things we teach in the MBA program about 4 P's and 3 C's and 5 forces and all the good business management principles so that you maintain efficient operations. Social mind is seat of the pants, decision making. Historically, corporations had business heart and business mind. They were in the business of making money, and obviously they used good management principles to make that money. And NGOs typically are social heart and social mind. They have a good heart, but they make seat of the pants decision making. I say every Indian corporation should move to this quadrant: social heart and business mind. That is what you see Narayana Health is. Dr. Devi Shetty is as shrewd a businessman as you can come across, but he has got the social heart. Every company in India must have the social heart and business mind if you really want to crack open India number two and India number three. And if you crack open India number two and India number three, I believe we will solve perhaps the single most important problem the whole humanity faces, and certainly India faces that too, which is income inequality. The difference in income between the rich and the poor has reached alarming proportions. Certainly that's true in India. Now, there are two ways to attack income inequality. One model of attacking income inequality, the extreme form of it, is communism. Communism attacks income inequality by making everybody equal, by making everybody poor. It doesn't work. It'll never work. In fact, in India, we tried a form of that. Since independence, we followed socialistic pattern of society. What was the result? The result was we made the country bankrupt. There is another way to attack income inequality, which is capitalism. The American form of capitalism, the 20th century capitalism, that too has miserably failed us. In fact, since 1993, India adopted American form of capitalism. Certainly, the GDP has grown. I don't deny that. GDP in 1993 was about 200 billion. Today is 2 trillion. So it grew 10x. But the income inequality has become worse. So the American form of capitalism doesn't work. Communism doesn't work. What is the answer? I say we must innovate capitalism itself. I firmly believe capitalism is the most potent tool to solve humanity's problems. But we must innovate capitalism. We must create responsible capitalism. What does responsible capitalism mean? It means corporations should use their resources and capabilities to unlock the value in India number two and India number three. Corporations use their resources to innovate for the rich in India number one, which is fine. But why don't you use your resources to also innovate for the poor, thereby close the income inequality? Narayana Health is closing income inequality. Narayana Health is a classic example of a capitalist. They make a lot of money. By the way, one of the primary investors in Narayana Health is private equity. And we know all about private equity. They are mercenaries. They will never invest unless they get the best return. And Narayana Health gives the best return. But at the same time, Narayana Health is closing income inequality. Because when you solve the problem of a heart attack for India number two or India number three, you're extending their productive life. There is nothing wrong in making money. You use your innovation to solve their problem. In the process, you also give them income mobility. The best way to solve income inequality is income mobility. And that requires breakthrough thinking. That requires nonlinear thinking. I say reducing income inequality is perhaps the biggest accomplishment of humanity in the next 25 years. And that is the opportunity Indian companies have. Thank you very much. It's about 2:20, so I don't know whether we have time for questions or we can pick it up.
I thought we could have two questions.
Okay.
We have students in the audience with mic. If you have any questions, please raise your hand. A student will come to you. There's a question here.
My name is Sandeep Singh. I'm from Kolar. First of all, thank you for an excellent presentation. It was really inspiring. My question is around the point which says that process beats talent. Now, often we've heard that processes also come in the way of innovation. So do you see inherent conflict there? And if yes, should processes be, how lean the processes should be to let the innovation breathe?
It's a great question. What I'm really meaning by process is not the kind of processes which limit innovation. I am saying, let us create a fundamentally different paradigm. Thereby, the talent, which is a limiter, is no longer a limiter. Because there is a real war for talent in India. And sometimes companies give up saying, I don't have talented employees. That's why I can't create this breakthrough innovation. And I say, if we can create a different paradigm, that's what I mean by process, then the current talent is not needed. You redefine talent, is the way I will put it.
Hi, sir. Good afternoon. I'm Simarpreet from Hartek. Sir, my question is that what is the difference between innovation and invention? We keep on talking about innovation, but what's your take on that?
You see, innovation is executing invention. Invention is could be a technological breakthrough, could be an idea. Innovation, you see, invention is not innovation. Innovation is commercializing invention. Innovation is executing on invention. That's the big, and therefore in many times, you don't even need any technological breakthrough to come up with a really non-linear innovation. So that's the distinction I want you to keep in mind.
Hello, Mr. Govindarajan. My name is Viral. Excellent principles, I think, eye-opening. I'm a founder of a startup, and my question is, how do you instill a thinking and process of innovation in your team, in your employees? So perhaps if you spend time in GE, which is a really large team, right? I saw you said that it cannot happen in big teams, in large organizations. We have the benefit of a really small team and would like to understand how do you sort of instill that process of innovation in your team?
In fact, I would say small startups, because they lack resources, lack of resources could either be limiting or liberating. In fact, I find creating an innovation culture in a small team is lots easier than in big companies which have resources. Because they have resources, that itself creates a trap. Because resources sometimes makes you really stay with the same industry business model. Dainik Bhaskar lacked resources. It was a small startup. Because they lacked resources, they created a completely different way of launching newspapers. Therefore, in a way, I would say lack of resources is actually a great incentive.
Yeah. Hi, sir. Good afternoon. My name is Mr. Hare Krishna. I have a question. Narayana Health is one of the great example which you have given in the entire presentation. And we would really look into more in terms of learning from this company. Could you give us a few more examples from Indian perspective, like Narayana Health, which we can look forward to in terms of, you know, learning to create a world-class organization or a world-class company like Narayana Health has done?
Great question. In fact, this week, I was with two organizations which are almost on par with Narayana Health, I would say. One of them is HCG Oncology. I met this gentleman, Dr. Vishal Rao. Amazing, amazing person. And I want you to make a note of that and make sure you come in contact with him. Dr. Vishal Rao is an oncologist. You see, in India, the best of the best are encouraged to do medicine. And in medicine, the best of the best go to oncology. So he must be a very smart guy. And he could have certainly made a ton of money by treating rich patients. And he is a throat cancer specialist. In throat cancer, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3 throat cancer, you don't lose your voice box. Stage 4 throat cancer, you lose your voice box. when you lose your voice box, you can't speak. And there are devices which can restore voice, but they cost $1,500. That's what Michael Douglas has, the great actor. When he lost his voice box, he was able, he's rich, he can afford a $1,500 device. Most of the patients in India, because they go for cancer treatment very late in their, in the stage of the disease, most of them lose their voice box. And he got an inspiration when he saw a security guard who hadn't spoken for 16 years. He lost his voice box and lost his job. Of course, we are a security guard, can't speak. Obviously, you're not going to get a job. And he said, I must solve the problem. He is obviously in India number three. So Dr. Vishal Rao has innovated a $1 voice box. And that $1 voice box is as high a quality as the $1,500 voice box. And this security guard has gotten the voice back and got the job back. And this is a remarkable innovation, which he is now patented. He is now going to take it to the US. That's one example. A second example I met is Muruganandam. You may have heard of him. He's called the Tampon King. You see, feminine sanitary pads. This is a huge problem in India, particularly in rural India, when women reach that stage, when they don't, because the sanitary pads offered by P&G, Kimberly Clark, Johnson & Johnson are so expensive, they cannot afford it. So they either use really bad materials, which injures their health, or they drop out of school. And what Dr. Muruganandam has done is to create an ultra-low-cost sanitary pad. And his innovation is really 3D printing. That's what he has done. Because most of the sanitary pads produced by P&G, or Johnson & Johnson, Kimberly Clark, are produced in big factories. And they cannot be distributed economically into rural India. That's why it's so expensive. What he has done is to create a small machine that can produce 10 sanitary pads, but he has decentralized manufacturing. His basic innovation is coming up with that machine. Today, he has created 1 million jobs, because these machines he sells into a village. A village woman buys this and then makes the sanitary pad just for that village, so you only need a small volume. Phenomenal innovation. So there are many, many such examples in India we can learn from. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.